So it sounds a bit odd to use microphones in such a small room, but this is for the people over there. Hi, those people on the internet. And of course, if you have something to say, you have to come out the front and use the microphone as well. Okay. Just we'll introduce ourselves in a second. Well, in fact, we'll do that now, shall we? Do you want to say who you are?
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Good afternoon. Are we happy? Thank you for coming to this session. And I hope we are going to interact and enjoy this. My name is Mostaf Matesanwa. My surname is very long, so if you just call me Mostaf, it's okay. Pakwe is my scout name. I come from Zimbabwe, but I'm currently working with the regional office in Nairobi. Thank you.
Is that it? We got any children?
Yes, I have three children, two daughters and one son.
Very impressive.
Probably a brief history about myself. I joined the movement as a cub and I rose through the rank. Before I left for Nairobi in 2011, I was chief commissioner of the Scout Association of Zimbabwe. So I've been a trainer since 1994. Thank you.
Okay, and my name is Stephen Peck. My second name, my family name is very short, so that's easy to remember, unlike my staff. And I work for the UK Scout Association, and I work at Gilwell Park, which is, where is my scarf? Who's stolen it? You've stolen it, yeah. It's the Philippines. Never trust a Filipino. one of my role in UK Scouting is as a director of what's called Program and Development. But one of my roles is also as the chief, the camp chief of Gilwell Park, which is why I have these funny beads. But today we're here to talk about the Woodbadge. As I made a joke earlier on, but it's quite serious. The session is called The History and the Future. But you've had the history now, okay? We're not going to talk anymore. We're not going to give you a lecture about the history of Woodbadge. You can read that everywhere on the internet if you wish. What we're going to do is look at what is currently happening and look at the future, okay? But we're going to do that in a session which involves you people giving us ideas, okay, and sharing ideas. It said on the session site that this was highly interactive, and it will be highly interactive. So, what I need you to do now, please, is to stand up, okay? And you might be able to just sit back down, but if you're sitting with people from your own country, okay, can you move somewhere where they are not? Because one of the things we're going to ask you to do in these small groups is to share ideas between countries. So we really need you to move around. So if there are lots of people sitting together, can you just move, change chairs so that you are sitting in a small group with other people? Is this a problem? Thank you. Is that okay? Can we move around? If you're okay where you are, if you're sitting with lots of other people, then that's fine. Just sit down.
Yeah, you're good.
Right, we're going to stop the photography now, and you can do that later. Here, no, come on, give it up. Right. No, on a serious note, if you want to take pictures later, that's fine, but we need to get on, okay? So, that's great. We'll leave it there. Right, so this is going to be, Mustaf and I are really genuinely going to act as facilitators, not lecturers, okay? We just want to make that very clear. We know some of the sessions that you have been to have involved lectures and people telling you information and things, and that will not be the case here. We might give you some ideas, but we are looking for you to share what happens in your association at the moment, what is good, what is bad, and we will share that between us and then see, give you some ideas for the future of how you may be able to develop Woodbadge training. Now, we can comment, and help you with some of those ideas, but most of the ideas will come from you. Is that okay? Is that clear? So it will not be a lecture. Please don't expect that. So you're going to have to work. If you don't want to work, leave now. It's okay. We don't mind. No? Everybody's happy? Good. Okay. Right. Mustafa. Where you go?
Okay, now this is what we are aiming to do, and we hope that by the end of this session we'll have explored firstly the diversity of the Woodbadge training around the world, reflect on current delivery of Woodbadge in your NSO, yeah, and also how can your NSO curriculum be developed. Then lastly, identify further where further help and advice can be sourced. Because the Woodbadge, as you may know, it's very diverse, that every country has its own way of doing it, although the structure seems to be the same. But if you ask someone who tell you Woodbadge, some they do one stage, some they do no practical, some they do practicals. So it's very diverse. So maybe at the end, we would then see after this Congress, what do we think could be the right way to go? Then we can share that.
The first aspect we want to look at is what is the purpose of Woodbadge training in your association? When you start talking in your small groups, you will realize that for some people, it is about their personal development, not about skills. It comes very late in their scouting career. For some people, it comes very early. It's for new scouters to learn as part of their learning process as they start their scouting journey. For some people, it's based around competency and the judgment of competency. And for some people, it is a sort of a mystical thing which is only achieved by scouters who have been around for 30 or 40 years. Okay? It's true. It's true. Okay? And what we'd like you to do is just answer the question, what is the purpose of Woodbadge training in your NSO? So we'd like you to turn to the people nearest to you, and in your interpretation, what is the purpose of it? Why is it there? Where does it come in the life of a scouter? What is the purpose? Okay, it's a clear question? Yes? You will see this is the first of many discussions we'll be having, but you will see as soon as you start to discuss it, the diversity that we have. We are not making a judgment on this, but you will see there is a huge diversity. Okay? So, answer this question. What's the purpose of Woodbadge training in your NSO? Hi, guys. We're going to give you 2 more minutes. 2 more minutes, that's all. Right, okay, ladies and gentlemen. Can I ask that group in the corner there to split for the next discussion? Is that all right? Because we think it's a bit too big for what we're trying to achieve. So what we're going to ask you to do... It's obviously very exciting, isn't it? Lots of people talking. What we're going to ask you to do is to, for each of these discussion points, is to just feed back to us the diversity that you found in your group. We're not here to make a judgment about whether something is good or bad, okay? I may have a comment, but it will be a personal comment, okay? But what we want you to do is to understand that there are lots of different ways of developing, of delivering Woodbadge training and training for leaders, and that in your association, in your NSO, you don't have to stick with one model, and that lots of other people have really, really good ideas about the way they deliver, some of which are not appropriate for your NSO or your culture or your at this point in time in your association. And that's fine, but you can aspire to do some different things, okay? Does that make sense? So that's what we're seeking to do. We're seeking to understand why people do things differently and what purposes they are. And you go away thinking, well, we don't do that very well. We should aspire to do something better and have more thoughts to it. But it's not for us to tell you what you need to change. Does it make sense? So that's why we're going to have some of these discussions. Hence the statement before about it being a truly facilitated session, not a lecture. Okay? The ideas will come from you. All right? And when we start again, are you okay to split, please? All right? Because if we're going to do that... Yeah. Good answer. Right. All right, come down and beat you. Ooh. Fade out on. This is all recorded, and it would. And I take back everything I said about Filipinos earlier on. All right, that's, he's a very good friend of mine. Okay, what did you find when you started to talk about the purpose of Woodbadge? What did you find? We're just going to write some notes up here, and I'm going to have to repeat some of the things that you say so that we don't pass the microphone around. All right. So what did you find? What was the purpose that you found, the diversity? Good. You were talking about something, so come on. Hello. So personal development of the leaders. That was the purpose of it. Okay? Change the pen, she's saying. You can't read it. Right. How's that? This is very bad writing, so I'm sorry. So you're saying personal development of the leaders. All of you. Okay, you feel the same? Anything different from that? Interesting question, isn't it? Yeah. So where does it fit? You know, is it a long-term aspiration for long service in scouting? Or is it for new leaders as they come through to help them with their skills? So any other words that you would put up there about the purpose of Woodbadge? Right. So skills... Can I use the word skills? Or, but you're saying very practical stuff, so running a unit. Right. Quality scouts. From Woodbadge? Okay. Any other word that people would use about the purpose? I'm not trying to cut you out here, I'm just interested. Yeah, go on. A qualification, sorry. What was the first thing? Standard level. Right, okay. So try and, it's sort of quality control, yeah, for scouting and some sort of qualification. We'll come back to qualification in a minute. So it's linked up with the personal development side of things. Okay. Yeah? Is that fair? All right. Sorry, as I say, I'm not trying to put words in your mouth. I'm trying to repeat back and make it sure. Right. So it's a destination. Okay. So final stage. Right, Australia, what's the purpose of your training? Of the whole scheme. What does that mean? Okay. So you got skills here, quality scouting. Okay. Interesting, the word that isn't up there is about competency. Okay, and we've got we've sort of skirted around that a bit, but about you know, skills to run a unit, quality scouts, quality scouting. You know, actually, your point. You know, without if we want to have quality scouts, we've got to have quality scouting, and without properly trained leaders to do that, that's fine. It's a very interesting thing about how we balance the development of skills to provide quality scouting with a personal development journey. Now, the two things are not incompatible, but actually they have to be in a balance in some way. And I would suggest in some associations they're not in balance. You know, it's either one or the other too much. But actually, what we're saying here across this diversity is about what I personally, and here's a comment I would make personally, I have a problem about it just being a long-term goal for someone. You know, actually, it's not an award for long service. It's a part of a journey to help you be a quality scouter. All right, and I think that's really important. Yes, Sweden. Right, now that's a very interesting point, and Peter started to do that. Do you just want to explain what you mean by that a bit more? Right. Yeah. And I think that's a really important distinction. And we need to have a common language here before we go any further here. For some people, Woodbadge is new leader. So you have a new leader here, and it goes to Woodbadge. What you're saying in your country, and it's not exclusive, is that you have training here, but Woodbadge is this end bit. Okay? So when you're talking amongst yourselves, you have to be very clear about what we're talking about. And I think what the rest of the questions we're going to be asking you are really about the journey of a leader to develop all the skills they need. So Woodbadge is the what we call a Woodbadge course is the end of a training process. But what we're referring to really is the whole of that process to the point where someone gains their Woodbadge. Does that make sense? Just so we have a common language here. All right, it's really important. Sandra. Okay. Sandra, I'm sorry. Okay. You can't hear that, but Sandra's saying he's trying to translate into French from very bad English, and that takes a long time. Okay? So you'll have to excuse me if I speak slower. I'm sure everyone would appreciate that. I only speak English, okay? So if I talk too fast, thank you for saying, can you just shout or throw things or something? All right? No, don't apologize. It's my fault entirely. I get too excited. So, in conclusion, I think we need to... Therese. Okay, we'll put young people here. Excuse my writing. But I think for me it was sort of there, quality scouts, quality scouting, but I agree about the focus on young people. But I think the question I would pose to you is trying to get a balance. I wouldn't argue with any of these things, but trying to get a balance across all these things. You know, it's not just a personal development journey. It's not just about skills. It's not just about leadership. It's about providing quality scouting for young people, and that's a mixture of all those things there. And it's getting the balance right across the whole curriculum for your training program. Yeah? Interesting discussion, I think. You know, certainly the variety that we've seen. Okay, we're going to move on. We're going to ask you several more questions. You share and then we're going to have a little bit of debate in between each one. Does that make sense? Yeah? Is it warm enough, cold enough? It's okay? Right, good stuff.
Anyone with more comments?
No,
not comments. But
sorry, we've got something on the internet here, Mustaf.
Yeah, so we have a comment from Belgium. I just read it out for you, for all of you here. In Belgium, Woodbadge training for scouters who have already some experience in scouting and mostly follow already an introduction training on practical leader stuff. However, they reflect that their scouters and their Woodbadge training scheme is mainly of their participants are between 17 to 25. And one of the issues that the Belgium scouts would like to arise is that usually the scouters just stay for a shorter time frame and just they will leave scouting section after 25.
Right. Yeah. Belgium has a very unusual situation. Anyone from Belgium here? Some of the associations in Belgium have a very, for many associations, an unusual position where there are very, very few people over the age of 25 involved in scouting. Even on their national board, their commissioners, once you get to 25, 26, you are too old to be involved. Okay? A lot of very frightened people in this room. Yeah. There's a lot of people just decided they won't move to Belgium. But it's a very interesting situation. You know, can you complete this journey in that time scale? I'm not asking you to comment. I'm just saying it's an interesting, you know, because there are many associations represented here. People wouldn't start their Woodbadge until they were 25, I suspect. Really interesting. So it's a particular problem. Anyway, Mustaf,
yes,
away we go.
I just want to say I think what has been listed is very, very interesting, but it doesn't run away from what most of us are doing. But since we are also looking the past, I just have a quote from the founder about the Woodbadge or about training. To make quite certain that when I am gone, the future leaders of scouting will really understand what it is all about and what my intentions have been. So, I think we are more or less in the direction, but I think his main aim was to produce or to have a leader with some ideas to support young people. So if the Woodbadge itself does not direct the leader to have some skills to support the young person, probably it could be like it's diverting its purpose. That's my personal view according to this quote. Thank you. I think we move on to the next. I know Ghana was raising a hand. Maybe while we are
I'm going to change the next. The great thing about quoting from BP is that he wrote so much that you can always find something to support whatever you want to say, really.
Okay, now we move on. Structure. We have explored the purpose. What is the structure? Already here, some people are already talking something similar to a structure in the way things are. So let us explore how is the Woodbadge structured in your NSO. That's one. A series of courses, a series of modules, or a secret? A secret, it could be very interesting here, but I know in many NSOs you don't know how the Woodbadge is being given. And you have to do this, you have to know somebody in order to get one. It has happened, you have to go through different things, different from others. Some it's easier, some it's difficult. So let's hear from your point of view. 10 minutes. One more minute. Okay. Okay, I'll give you 30 seconds. Okay. I know that we need more time, but we don't have the time. So, who is our first reporter? Our first correspondent?
We have a series of courses on paper. Some are organized as modules, and then they get delivered as courses. And we also said that the general feeling amongst the six NSOs was that we recognize prior learning. So some people may think the course is a secret because they do something different to someone else, because they bring a different set of skills to the advanced training.
Thank you very much. That was you have been trying to answer the secret question. that's very good. Any comments? The ice has been broken already, so just get them.
We are at least three different NSAs that have included a personal project in between courses or modules, which you do on your own, maybe or maybe not, in together with a mentor or a coach or something like that. But a personal project is part of it as well.
Very good. Any other comments from other groups?
One of the things that was very obvious was the length of time and the combination of whether it was online learning or face-to-face learning. And so I think here we had a range from maybe less than a year to 3 years to possibly forever to get a wood badge. So maybe less than a year to... A long time.
Prior to the Woodbadge course, a candidate has to undergo the three courses. three courses he has to undergo. Number one is general information course, then basic course, then advanced course. After advanced, he has to get one more certificate, that is study course. Certain questions are given in the study which related to the all the books of scouting, and he has to do some community service at the national level registration. Then only the scouter is eligible to undergo the Woodbadge course.
Wow.
And the duration of the Himalaya Woodbadge course is 8 days. It is an 8 days course, and it is considered as highest technical course so far as unit leader is concerned.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I think there are very interesting points here. Very interesting points.
I'll tell you what, I've got a real, real respect for anyone who gets a wood badge in India.
For your information, every year we are conducting 8 wood badge courses in the country. No, we have 5,000 Himalaya wood badge holders in our country, and 900 trainers we have.
Yes, yes. That is very interesting. I think the question of time is one of the issues which probably from this Congress we need to relook at. Do we really need to have 10 years doing the same course? I know that some people even ask, if you are doing a PhD, maybe it's 3 years, in some country 2 years, in some country 3 years as a maximum. So if you are doing Woodbadge, you take 15 years. So I think these are some of the issues which we really need to think about and say, do we really need to take 20 years to have the bids? And so on. I think these are some things which we can reflect on. Do we have any comments? Yes.
Oh, on camera. I have a comment on on the duration of the Woodbadge. I'm one of those who did the Woodbadge and never completed it. Not because I failed. Sorry, I'm not ashamed of that. But it was structured in lots of modules, the practical and theory. When you leave the country for career or other reasons and you are on the Woodbadge, it's very difficult to come back. Unfortunately, that was my I never handed in. You had to do sort of a thesis, structured thesis right at the end. I never submitted that. Now, coming to the question of do you really have to take that long? This is more voluntary organization. Maybe the shorter we keep it, I'm not saying shorter 6 months, at least to the maximum 2 years, between 1 to 2 years. It also we ensure that the scouts can achieve. We've got serious problems now of volunteers in adult leadership. Thank you.
I think this decision is not for us to say be 2 years. It's the decision must be from the NSO.
So my name is Andreas. I represent the Scouts of Azerbaijan. I'm the National Training Commissioner. Now, I think what we mostly need to face is first the purpose. So if the purpose in the end is to deliver quality scouting, and the person in which we are facing is the troop leader, okay, we need first to have a step in which the troop leader will understand what is scouting and how does he apply that in the age group that he is a leader. And then coming up to the Woodbadge, why does he apply that? So the purpose of the duration is how quickly you can rise from basic scout open-air nature skills to understand the fundamental educational principles of the scout method. Okay, and this is the duration. Now, many NSOs have different approaches. Most of them have a three-stage Woodbadge training in which they have a thesis that needs to be written. They have a tutor, okay, who helps out on this condition. Then you have the module, what was discussed from the brother from India, this 8-day could be 5 days or 4 days or 6 days in different NSOs. And then probably you have a third stage in which you need to show in practice, okay, probably to your tutor, that you can deliver in practice these skills. So if we orientate the Woodbadge as a personal development of the scout leader in a troop level, okay, I think that the duration will be easily then accepted on special issues of different NCO and different communities. Thanks.
Thank you very much. We get the last comment from, so that we need to move. Yeah,
thank you very much for the opportunity. I'm looking at the Woodbadge. Look as if all our discussion is looking at the unit leader. But currently in scouting, we have people who are at the administration level who are also willing to do the Woodbadge. By the end of the day, they will be operating in the office or not on the field as the unit leader will do. In such way, how do you, what are the course content for such people, even though they are with scouts? Thank you.
I think that's a different approach.
That's very very interesting discussion, actually. And you'll understand that this session, you know, we've structured it this way because that, you know, it could go on and on forever. But you're right, we're focusing on unit leaders or people who work directly with young people. But many of our roles in this room, I guess, are not working with young people. Our job is to work with adults. Our job is to support adults. You know, our job is to lead a team of adults. And quite often as a unit leader, our job is to lead a team of adults, let alone being a commissioner. So actually, our training has to respond to the person's, your opinion is absolutely correct. The training has to respond to the person's position and what they will do in scouting, as well as being a personal development journey. It's not good me teaching, me showing you that I can do a square knot when actually my job is to look after adults. You know, it may not be relevant. We're going to move on, guys, all right, because we've got a lot to get through. One comment from Belgium.
Yes, just in Belgium, the Miss, I don't know how to explain, pronounce his name or her name, but then he or she told us that the training that will be in free path, that we can, that they can do the Woodbadge in a building, as a camp or as a hiking. And then the Woodbadge will consist of 8 days face-to-face course, or more or less, and 6 months later, weekend follow-up, and then there will be their Woodbadge course.
Thank you, Belgium. That's very good, Luke. Very helpful. This is Luke. You can't see him. I'll just turn the camera around and you can wave at Luke. Luke, we know Luke's there. I'm going to get in trouble now for moving the camera. No one's ever done that. I'm going to get in so much trouble now. Never mind. Right, we're going to have to move on. All right, what we want to look at, we've looked at the sort of purpose where we got the sort of structure. And again, you can see the variety of structures here that are there that suits whatever role you're in, and you know whether this sort of approach, as Mustafa was saying, you know, does it need to be that complicated? Well, in some countries, maybe the answer is yes, it does, because that's what we want to be. You know, I'm not making a value judgment on some of this stuff, but as I say, I do have a lot of respect for people who get a Woodbadge in India. Methods. What methods do we use in our training? And we've touched on this a bit, so we're going to keep this section quite short. But people have talked a lot about courses, but also you've talked about, somebody mentioned, I think Peter mentioned something about online learning or e-learning or workbooks and things like that, you know, one-to-ones. But also we're coming back to making the training suitable for the person. Do you have personal learning plans? What range of methods do you use for the person who's doing the training all the way through? Okay, so we're going to have a short discussion, just have a quick chat about that, trying to get a list together of the range of methods that you use for the person going through it. Your 1 minute warning, 1 minute warning. Okay, guys, this is not... this is not a test. It's a generation of ideas, so... Hello? Yeah. We're there. Really good. Who is? Oh, this guy. Oh. We've got someone from Sri Lanka watching us as well. Except, who is anyone from Sri Lanka here? If you know people from Sri Lanka, they have enormous names, so I'm not even going to try and pronounce it. Luke, I can do, but this person's name I can't. So, hello, Sri Lanka. Someone watching. So, just give me some ideas. What came from your the list of methods? What methods do you use? This very attractive woman here will pass you a microphone. I have to say that because I'm married to her.
I am Balu from Hungary. We use basically the scout method. And after when we finish that, well, we use the e-learning, the homework, and the learning by doing method use as they must do a project during the training. They are the project leader, and they finish the project in a half a year.
Thank you, Ronald. Thank you. It's really helpful. Anybody want to add to that?
Our group, we think, we agree that an effective way method is a small group and the face-to-face method.
Thank you.
Well, we've got a range. We've got all the way from 100% online in a relatively few hours, which could be accomplished over a course of a few weeks, to part online and part face-to-face, which might take anywhere from 6 months to a year, to all face-to-face, which might take a year, year and a half, to if you want Woodbadge, you can only attend a national course, and it's only held every other year.
Right. Okay.
I find what was common to add on what's already said was also reflection time, individual reflection time for many of the courses here in our group.
Okay. Can you just explain that a bit more? Because I think that would be that's an unusual thing for some people. So what do you mean by reflection time?
Well, I can speak for my own organization.
Yeah.
It's not sure that it's completely the same,
no.
But at least to have some time during the training, so during the modules, where you can either go for yourself to have a room to reflect on what you've learned. It could also be reflection in groups. So maybe to sum up of the training of the day, maybe in the evening, you sit together with a couple of others, reflect on what was the key message of the day. What do I take from here? Or right. It could be reflection through email, which was another example from a guy in our group, where you're actually getting some reflection question through email that you're answering to. So sitting on your own and reflecting on what does this mean to me.
Right. Okay. Great point. Thank you. Is there someone else there? Yeah, there is. India? What do you have to do? Walk on glass, do you?
Yes, we have the method of training is, number one is learning by doing.
Right.
Then we are also giving project work. Then we have also a lecture method.
Right.
Then we too have the demonstration method.
Right.
On the first day, we just demonstrate all the model tent base, model gadgets, all kinds of fire, anchorages, hold fast, a model kitchen.
Right.
All those things has to be prepared for the participants well in advance. Then we have the self-learning. Right. We have the self-learning.
Come on in.
We create an opportunity for the participants to learn by themselves. Then another thing is we have a petrol system method. Petrol system.
Oh, we got small groups, yeah.
Petrol system means whatever subject we are teaching through the troop meeting. So that the unit leader who are taking part in the program should run the unit effectively after going back the course.
Okay.
Then individual assignment.
Right.
Individual assignment.
Yeah.
Then we have a group assignment. Group assignment to patrol assignment, you can say.
Okay, anything else to add?
Then, in addition to this, we have the tests. In addition to that,
hang on, guys, otherwise, we're never going to get out of here. Quickly, come on.
In addition to this, we have a test that is called STA, spare time activity.
Right.
I mean, after the lunch and before the next session start, that is STA time.
Okay.
In that, all the skills what wow. we taught will be assessed.
Okay. You so do make it hard, don't you? Yeah. Okay, thank you. That's really helpful. Do you want to make one quick... is there an addition to this?
In Oman. First, we have face-to-face course. It will be in 7 days. Full 7 days.
Right.
Okay. Then he will get the projects. At least 6 projects from 10 projects. This project, he should... to do it with the scout group. After that, the guide will see the project, then he signature it like this. My English is not okay. Then he will get the wood badges.
Okay.
It will be when we have 3 steps. First course, second course, third course. Yeah, it will be, I think, at least 2 years.
Right.
Yeah, two years you can get the wood badge.
Thank you.
Thank
The thoughts I would leave you with here, and we are going to have to move on. Hang on, we got one more. Sorry.
Sorry, just a quick comment. I'm from Singapore. So normally at the very beginning, we have an induction course before the Woodbadge course. So the induction course is something like, it used to be something like this. They spend a whole day in a classroom sitting. But since about 2 years ago, we changed it because the feedback was they weren't getting enough practical experience. So we actually do it right now on a Saturday with an actual scout meeting going on. And we do the training and they can see for themselves what's happening as well. So this is one of the methods we've done.
Right. Sort of on the job, really. Interesting, huge variety of methods now that we use. You will have known, you know, over the last 20 years, this list has got a lot longer. All right, the methods that are available to us has increased. It used to be, and Barry was saying with a sort of tongue in his cheek, you know, you could only do certain courses at certain times, and you had to go away for 8 days. You know, that was it. And it was pass or fail. You add to this all the things that you can do now. You know, projects have been around for a while, I know, but sort of e-learning, workbooks, reflection time. You know, we've got all this variety of methods available to us. The thing that I would leave you thinking about is, actually, if we're helping people to develop personally, if we're helping them to understand the Scout method, then there is a movement to move a lot of this training online. And actually, I'm nervous about that personally, because actually I'm thinking one of the things that people get out of courses is about the feeling of community, the understanding of residential experiences with other people, and the personal development that comes with living with other people. Now, I'm not against online learning by any means. What I am saying is everything in balance. You have to have that balance there. And I just leave you with that thought. However, the other side of that is that we need to be more flexible. People have different jobs, different types of lifestyles. They can't always give up an hour, a week of their time just to do a Scout course. Their family pressures, all sorts of things. So providing that flexibility for people is really important. But it's all these things in balance. And I would encourage you to think as flexibly as you can whilst staying with the core of what we're trying to achieve. Okay? So, huge list of methods there available to us. And you've heard some really good examples around the room. Hunt these people down and go and ask them what they do, because there are some really, really good examples, I know, in this room. Okay, we're going to move on, I think. What are we moving on to?
Quality control.
I think this is where we have a lot of problems or issues. As you know, that the Woodbadge is worn worldwide. So if in this room, if you have a scarf and a Woodbadge, you look the same. But what you did is different. So now, in order to keep that standard or to ensure that people are not just buying them from the scout shop, what do we have in place to control our quality? So how is your training moderated? Do we come here with a cup of tea and we chat about our families and so on, and then we say, okay, we've done for the day? And then, how are the trainers trained? How often is the training reviewed? I was in one country which I will not mention. When I arrived there, they were still using content of 1973 to train. So I don't know whether that content was still relevant, but how do we often review? And mostly I've heard people saying the youth program need to be reviewed, but I've never heard people saying the training need to be reviewed. So, what evaluation methods do you use? 3 minutes.
We Noted.
One minute. We need to continue this discussion online after the Congress. Any quick thoughts? Eh?
Which one? The PowerPoint. Which PowerPoint? This one. Yeah, you can share.
Who wants to break the ice?
Australia actually, Australia has their Woodbadge training accredited by an outside accreditation agency so that the participants actually get a certificate. And so they've got an outside organization doing accreditation of training materials and methods and trainers, which is kind of an interesting philosophy. I don't know if that would go over very well with the old Woodbadgers in Houston, Texas, but sounds like a heck of a good idea.
Yes, that's a good point there. Any? Anyone? But you're from the same group, yeah? We need a different group.
And our group was really... Yeah, we're really mixed from many different countries, and the training is reviewed quite frequently, from 3 to 5 years. So it's really reviewed. But we all more or less agreed that quality control can be improved, because even though the training is reviewed, it's only by samples or by asking specific person, but not that each course that had been done is really evaluated in a way that the quality can be improved by this. So,
good point. India? India here? Yes.
Yeah. In India, we have review every after 3 years. All the leader trainers of the country will sit together
and discuss, and it is based on the advancement of youth. If something is to be changed in the advancement, for example, signaling is to be introduced recently. Earlier it was deleted. So again, it has to be introduced. So on the basis of need of young people, those subjects are included in the training subjects. And so far as review is concerned, item number 3, how often is the training reviewed? We have a reorientation course for trainers. Every trainer has to qualify once in 4 years, reorientation course for trainer. It is a must for the assistant leader trainer and for the leader trainer. Yes, every after 4 years, they have to qualify. And in addition to this, they should assist at least 2 courses in 2 years, 1 course in 1 year. And they should submit the biennial report in order to renew their honorable charge for another 2 years.
Very interesting. Very interesting. In some parts, once you are a trainer, you are a trainer for life. Whether you you participate or you don't participate, you are a trainer.
In the Philippines, I just want to share the item, the second item, the trainers, how trainers are trained. We deviated from the World Adult Resources manual, because in the Adult Resources manual, an assistant leader trainer can already lead a course for basic course. No, if he or she get the third bid or become an assistant leader trainer. But in our case, since we're heading into a more competency-based training for trainers, our warrant for assistant leader trainer goes only for effective instruction. So meaning, an assistant leader trainer cannot be a course leader for basic and advanced. The competency based on our assistant leader trainers are mainly focusing on the quality of instruction. For leader trainers, that's the only time we warrant people who are qualified to become course leader in basic and advanced course. So in that sense, ALTs or assistant leader trainers are highly effective instructors, and then leader trainers are highly effective course leaders. Unlike in the framework of the World Adult Resources policy, that if you become an assistant leader trainer before, you can already be a course leader for basic course. In our case, it's different.
Okay. Yeah. I think we stop there. We have to move on because our time is running. But we are not like exhausting everything. Is to allow you to continue this discussion so that the interaction keeps going.
I think there is some interesting points here that somebody mentioned it earlier on. I think Mustaf made a comment about it. But the thing about trainer training is too often people become get 3 or 4 beads and then that's where it stops. One of the comments we've had online about training generally and about leaders generally is Where does continuing professional development come into this? The problem that with having something like a wood badge that you have an end point where you get given something is people think that's it, that they're trained. You know, how do they go on? And I would suggest one of the weaknesses of a lot of wood badge courses or training systems is that our trainers are not trained. That our trainers don't undergo that continuous updating. And thank you for your contribution, Mr. India. And I was making fun, and I don't mean to, because I think this idea of having to re-qualify every 4 years and required to get trained again is something that's too often missing from many systems. The other thing, of course, is about moderating so that our leaders get the same experience wherever they go. And I think, again, too often in many associations, we don't have that moderation system that enables the consistent quality to be delivered to leaders. Can we just touch on one other thing, because it's already been talked about, so I'm going to pick on some people because I'm conscious of the time. Australia, either Peter or you, do you want to talk about Phil, do you just want to talk about external accreditation? I just want to touch on this is a really important development that's happening
in many places, and I don't want long lectures, guys. I want 1 minute summaries. And I'm going to ask. Yeah, he will. Yeah, thank you. I appreciate that. And Ireland, I'm going to ask you as well, because you've got a form of external accreditation. And Hong Kong, you've also got the qualification. You're on your qualification framework, aren't you? All right. Which is so we're talking about 1 minute summaries here, guys. So you've got some ideas. The reason we're touching on this is that this is an increasingly important development that's happening, where leaders expect to have some value for their professional development out of doing their scout training. People expect there to be a crossover here. They learn skills here that they can apply there. It's also good for promoting scouting. So, 1 minute summary there.
So, the Scouts Australia Institute of Training is a registered training organisation, like a polytechnic or a TAFE or a community college. The Woodbadge training has been mapped against the Certificate 4 level on the Australian Qualifications Framework. And so it means when someone finishes their Woodbadge, they also receive a Certificate 4 in frontline management. We also have a diploma as an option as well. But this means that our training programs have to be reaccredited with an accrediting body every 5 years. So the content and the structure. It also means that our trainers, so our assistant leader trainers and leader trainers, are required to hold the appropriate vocational training qualification and need to show ongoing evidence of professional development to maintain their currency of trainers. Otherwise, we lose our accreditation as a training provider.
Good summary. And I am sorry to cut you off, but have a word with Australia if you're interested in that. Who else was I picking on there? Hong Kong, do you just want to say what the...
In Hong Kong, a Woodbadge is accredited by the Polytechnic University for 9 credit. If you accumulate more, then you can get an undergraduate degree. Besides, for skill training, we have adventure-based training, leadership training, and expedition. We apply for the accreditation of the qualification framework in Hong Kong government under level 3, which is at the diploma level. We want our leaders, besides the scout qualification, to get something more in the society. That's what we are trying to do. Thank you.
Brilliant, thank you. That's a really helpful summary. Ireland, Therese, do you know about that enough? Because yours is external, similar.
Yeah, it's roughly the same. And also, we're going through a big review of our training at the moment. And in the review, we're looking at the external bodies and whether, can we review our training in that line. Also, our trainers are a member of an institute of training. Again, they need to have certain qualifications and experiences, and they need to keep their qualifications in place.
Thank you. The only other example I've had in the UK that it's also linked to, it's also linked to qualifications, but also by completing Woodbadge, you get an automatic membership of some professional institutes as well, which again is sort of externally validating training as well. I would encourage you, and we're coming to the end now, I would encourage you to seriously think about this and about how you can link it externally. It adds value to the learning that the leaders have done. It gives credibility to scouting, and it just helps people in their careers as well as their scouting. You don't have to compromise the quality of the scout training. Okay? You don't have to compromise it. These guys will tell you. Actually, you might have to conform to some other things, but you don't have to compromise the values of scouting and what we're trying to help leaders to do. Okay, we're gonna kill it there. A couple of further thoughts. Sorry, there is a lot of support around to help you develop your Woodbadge training. One of the purposes of this session was to try and link you up with people, and you can see the diversity of really good ideas that are around at the moment to try and stimulate some thinking in there. But the WSEC has a global support project where you can request people to come and help you as a consultant or give you some ideas, and people will come and help you. Your regional office has access to this bank of consultants who can come and help. Even if it's just to come to a meeting and share ideas and help you get ideas from other associations. We would strongly advocate links with other national scout organisations. But no NSO should ever just pick up someone else's training program and drop it into their association, ever. All right? Actually, a link can give you some really good ideas, but don't ever think that that what works there will work in your country. Always develop it. There's also, it goes without saying, a massive amount of information on various NSO websites. So feel free to have a look around, and you've met, I'm sure, some new friends here. We are gonna stop there, but thank you very much for your contributions. We'll dip back into the history once more, because my wife will kill me if I don't mention this. The first GilwellPark.org, so all wood badgers belong to the largest scout group in the world, the first Gilwell Park. So have a look at the website there. And we have some little evaluation forms for you to fill in. Thank you very much for your contribution.
Thank you.
All right. And we'll...